Well, I would like to thank to Professor Tomislav Šola and the Bessin Heritage for this wonderful opportunity to present the Penafiel Municipal Museum here today. And first of all, let me tell you where Penafiel is. It's a medium county in the north of Portugal, very near to Porto. It's about 35 kilometers, and it's in the countryside area, so this is not a cosmopolitan big city. We have around 70,000 inhabitants and a traditional small city where the museum is located. And so this is going wrong, okay. We are a public institution owned by the City Hall, and in terms of the organogram, as you can see, we are directly dependent on the mayor, which is a major advantage because we are close to the power of decision. And so the museum has an internal structure of 6 different services with a small team of 16 people, all very young and motivated, but also very highly qualified, and especially very flexible in terms of multitasking, because we are short on human resources, so I don't have enough people to put in one single service. So as you can see, people do work in several different areas. So our mission is very wide, because this is an identity and territory museum, and basically we are mostly the City Hall's department for the management and planning of the old cultural resources, and territory planning is also in our hands. And we are also a research unity for the local history and archaeology, basically the county's heritage, it's all in our hands. And so this museum was founded in 1948, so it's not a new museum, and it's dedicated to local history, archaeology, and ethnography. And it was always installed in temporary facilities until 2009. Nevertheless, the museum's work was already recognized, not only by our colleagues, especially since the 80s, which is why we were one of the first museums to be qualified to integrate the Portuguese network of museums in 2003. Also, the museum was already recognized by the City Hall as a very important department for advice and counseling in all cultural affairs. As far as the population concerns, we are always seen as a partner, as a support, and as a friend of the community, even before this big renovation we had in 2009. So, at this point, the main problem was the lack of human resources, of course, and the facilities, which were not enough and not suitable for the service we were becoming, and our work and evolution needed better conditions. And finally, in the 90s, there was this idea of beginning a project to construct a museum from zero, starting from zero. And this project cost 9 million euro. It was co-financed by European Union grants in 50% plus 25% in national participation, and the rest of the money was invested by the City Hall. And so it was the building already existed. It was an 18th century palace which was enlarged by a famous architect, Portuguese architect, Fernando Tavra, and his son, because he died in between. And it was a very big building, but very perfectly integrated in the urban net. So people do not realize the size of the museum, and it has no urbanistic impact in the city. So this is our home. This is the Museum of Penafiel, and this building is also an emblematic building for the local community, because it used to be a school, and so it was already filled with memories of the childhood of the whole community, because the school actually was there until 1978. So in 2009, finally, the museum was opened by the President of the Republic, and it was a big event, and the whole community was invited to participate. We didn't have enough room for everybody, so we had to come into the city and make it outside. which is an habit we have. And since then, we were awarded with several prizes. Last year, we had the Institution Award by the Portuguese Museology Association, but in 2010, we were the Museum of the Year, the Portuguese Best Museum, and we were also nominated for the European Museum of the Year Award from the European Museum Forum. So, along with the Institution Award, we also had the Best Museum Website Award. And so we have this website, which is very modern and cheerful, I think. It has four different languages, and actually it reflects the new image of the museum. So we are out of the gray and into the color. In this website, you can see the presentation, the collections, and you have all the information you need about the museum and our activities. And also, you can get to know a little bit of the permanent exhibition by having a small virtual visit to do. So, we now have five permanent exhibition rooms plus a sixth room, which is a temporary one, and it's also very used for big events because it has a good area. And in each room, we use a totally different museography design and five different soundtracks to create totally different environments in each room, almost like five small museums inside this big building, although they always have the same graphic image of identification. So, entering the museum now, as you can see, well, this is the permanent exhibition in numbers, as I call it. We use a lot of new technology, which is also a problem to maintain, of course, and this is an option that today we would reflect a little bit more, because actually this is a permanent headache for us, although it's very efficient to the public, not only for children and young adults, but elder people also think some of the interactive devices we have very interesting, and they actually play with them. So this is very good in one way and a headache on the other. So this is the plan of the museum. And very fast, I will show you a little bit of the permanent exhibition because you can see it on the website. This is the identity room. And the identity room basically has the evolution, the historical evolution of this territory, and also some attention given to some personalities and a few, very few selected objects that are important to the collective memory and identity of the people of Penafiel. So this is a room that it's more, how can I say, it's more appealing to the local visitors than to the outside ones. So this is also a Muslim lantern we have with an hologram, and people almost come and ask, how do we keep this light on every day, because this should burn. So this is just another aspect. The territory room has some issues from the beginning because it's an open space to the museum store. So in terms of objects, we had to go to the stones because they don't suffer much with light and temperatures. But we decided to keep it very interactive, and we have this device in the middle. It looks like a space shuttle, but it's actually an interactive animation which has a lamprey, and people touch it and the lampreys come and eat in your hand. And inside we have some films with different territories to show to the visitors and appeal to them to, from the museum, go outside and get to know the rest of the territory, the rest of the county. Also, we have some touch screens. And in the archaeology room, our main concern was to make objects understandable for those who are not archaeologists, because this is a constant problem. Everybody knows what a stone axe is, but if you do not display it in the correct way, knows how to function without the wooden part, which is not there, obviously. So this is our main concern in our room, in this room. And so we have many films and animated projections to explain that, but also very simple solutions like these drawings over here that complete the archaeological pieces so that people can understand them. In the crafts room, it's a totally different museography, and we have a lot of films that explain the traditional professions, and we join here the crafts with the intangible heritage of the two main feasts of Penafiel, and we linked it also with the two materials, the wood and the iron. And so we have also a lot of films and this virtual book, which is actually a digitalized copy of a book related to the Corpus Christi procession in Penafiel. And of course, this is not the book which is available to the public. It's in the archives. And now people can go to the museum and read it from the beginning till the end. We actually have a share there and people go and read this book, so we display it to the public. The Land and Water Room is the last one from the permanent exhibition, and it's the room where we treat the rurality of this territory, using a lot of films too, but it's a room where the objects are still very close to our daily life. This is not a room where you can find any national treasure. So it was a bit difficult to enhance some of these common objects, but I think we did quite well with some crazy solutions like hanging the boats. And it gives people different perspectives of the farmers and fishermen's life. So now we get to the educational service, which was one of our highest bets since the beginning of this new museum to reach the local and also the regional community and to increase the number of visitors. So we use the website to inform people about all the activities we have available, not only in the museum, in the headquarters, but also in our extensions and the routes we dynamized. And people can choose from the permanent exhibition rooms several activities that we have available, and then we always try to have some previous contact, especially with schools, to understand what people want from us and be able to respond to that. So this diversity of activities is actually a strategy that allow us to fidelize the public, especially the school public, in a very efficient way, because as you see, the museum is very big and these rooms are also very big, they have a lot of objects, and so we try that schools come to the museum and visit only one room. And then from that room they have several activities to choose and they only make one. And so this takes about 2 hours of educational and funny experience in the museum, which they usually repeat in more than 60% of the cases, and they return either the same year or the next year because they get curious to see the rest of the rooms and to explore the rest of the workshops we have available for them. So these activities are always conceived to sediment the information that we transmit during the guided visit in a practical and funny educational way, and we always try to adapt them to the every kind of public, not only children, but also older people, publics with special needs, etc. And we always keep our door open to any suggestion or special request. And as you can see, the material we use, it's actually garbage. And it's garbage for a simple reason, because we don't have enough money for the materials. We have around 1,000 children a month, and they always want to do the workshops, and workshops do consume materials, and so after first 6 months we're out of stock, so we had to improvise, and we started by improvising inside our team get to be creative and imaginative, and so we start bringing our own garbage from home and trying to adapt this this waste to the activities we wanted to do and explore. And so what happened was that we realized that children actually enjoy transforming garbage into new objects. And we started to include this aspect of environmental sensibilization, why the use of waste and why the recycle of things. And we spread the original net of the waste suppliers by our family, then by our friends, then by our colleagues from the other departments of the city hall. And finally, we got to the cafes and to local storages, and they gave us all their garbage for free. And it's really funny because this makes them feel very participative in our life. And they think they have this big contribution, and it is actually a big contribution. And it's very nice because it gives them a feeling of belonging and participation in our own activities. So every Christmas we go door by door having a, you know, just like a, a small gift in thanks of all the garbage they gave us every day. So the success of these activities led very quickly, only 2 or 3 months after the opening, to another project called the Sunday at the Museums, which is basically the program for families. It takes place on the last Sunday of the month. It's totally free. And the idea is that we have this workshop available with the theme of the object of the month. And the idea is to get the parents to work directly with the children with only a little support from the staff. So we are not there working with them, we're just helping and controlling. So this is a very participative project. We have a very fidelized public which come every single month, and they ask, well, next month what will we have? And then, well, we know who is coming. And after this project, we had to host birthday parties too, because they were requesting for this girl who goes every single month, and she was having her birthday on one of these activity days, and her mom just says, oh, could I bring the cake? And so, yeah, okay. So we did that. And the next week we were crowded with phone calls asking for the birthday party, so we had to invent them, and we did, of course. And after this came another project with a partnership for a local company that produces board games, and they produced this board game exclusively for the museum. We bought it, but in return they dynamize a monthly activity on the second month Sunday of the month for free with the games in the museum. So besides our own activities, we always try to host and support all kinds of activities that are coming from the local community, from concerts, reunions, book presentations, everything we can, we help and we host. And we also host the main events of the city hall, the official ceremonies, and the most charming ones too, the most charming events, because the museum is now seen as an excellent place and as a charming place to host. So everything goes there. So when there's not enough room, we just come into the street, and the city is ours. So usually the population embraces all our activities, as it was the case for this unforgettable concert for the EMEA ceremony last year. Besides the activities we have in the main building, we also have three extensions. We have an archaeological extension, which is Castro de Montemozinho, which has been excavated every single year since 1974, so it's a big area. And we do have their interpretative center with a small auditorium, a small exhibition, and we also do the guided tours and the activities that we usually conceive to these spaces. Another extension is the water mill of Ponte de Novelas, a parish nearby the city, which was a totally recovered water mill, which now is in functioning, and also one of the places where kids like to go because they think the flour comes from the package in the supermarket. And so we have to explain it. No, this actually begins with a little seed, and then comes to the supermarket. We have another ethnographic extension, which we opened this year in May, which is an olive press oil, and it's in Sivolid. It's a parish which is very far from the museum, so sometimes it's very difficult to go there and do the activities, but we accept every challenge, so we do it. And it's also a very important part of the traditional economic activities. Now disappeared, unfortunately. And this is our project, the project that we have in hands now. I call it Living Extension because I don't have another name for it. It's actually a village where people live every day. And some of you know it from last year's EMEA ceremony. And it all began with a rehabilitation project where the museum was involved from the very first second, and now it became a very active place and attractive place also, which has been supported by the city hall but also with some private investment. And now the whole village has had this makeover, let's say like that. And now we have the project for the construction of our interpretive center over there. We're just waiting for the money right now. Oh, God. And besides the educational services, one of our strongest areas is also heritage and management archaeology service. So we began 10 years ago by elaborating the Penafiel's heritage charge. We have almost 140 legally protected areas, and we do analyze every single project of construction in these areas, and we impose mandatory preventive measures for archaeological and landscape impact. And this work in heritage has provided a lot of other projects, evaluation, promotion, and also some academic and scientific projects that we are very proud to do. So basically we do everything, since the sign to the root to the conservation, and when we get our nose into the project, sometimes they get altered and they have to integrate remains that we discover. So this is just a couple of examples. This was the one that we had in hands this year. It's not concluded, but almost. It's right in the city center. And of course, that all this knowledge we try to share with the public, from the simple form of the flyers that we do very often, to our series of publications, and we have more than 20 titles. We have 3 different lines of publication, and so this is available in the museum store, which is also a place where you can buy the local products, because now we have a partnership with the local producers, and everybody wants to be associated with the museum, which is nice, but very hardworking. So now if you want a good jam or a good wine, just go to the museum because we have it. So some of the producers do want a direct connection with us, and that's why we have other kinds of partnerships regarding the link of our image to the product, which is great because in this way we get publicity all the time, and vice versa, of course. And so after 2009, there was a little change in the way that people saw the museum, see the museum now. So the museological community always looked at us very closely, but now more than ever. And we are very happy to see that our own colleagues recognize that 2 years after being awarded with the best Portuguese Museum Prize, they kept looking at us. And so they realized that we are much more than just a nice building and a pretty exhibition, which is great. So another one of our characteristics is that we are an open arm museum, so we collaborate with everyone. The City Hall also has in the museum one of the most cheering departments, because finally we are a motor of local development, and especially we are one of the most important reasons why people do hear about Penafiel. So we did put Penafiel in the map, and the City Hall recognizes that, so we have the full support of the political executives, thank God, otherwise we couldn't work. And so we are actually the surplus value to promote the council, not just the city, but also the council of Penafiel. And we are now even closer to our community. Both local and regional, which is they have a very strong feeling of belonging and true affection towards the museum. So we are very happy to share with them everything we have to give. And so just to conclude and to keep the guidelines of the presentation, I think the thing I would never do would be to turn my back into this wonderful community and give them anything less than my very best try to work for them and to give them this museum and all this project is. Thank you.